Thanks, Divakar. Good evening and welcome to KCC 38. Okay, so I have proud privilege in introducing Ganesh, first speaker of the day. And Ganesh is from Cognizant. He is currently business analyst with the Knowledge Management Department. And he has done his graduation in Computer Science Engineering from Shastra, and he went on to do his Master's in Knowledge Management from NTU Singapore. And after that, he has been with Cognizant for 3 years now. And his research interests are in the area of knowledge management, analytics, application of mathematics in social network analysis, and also development economics, that are research areas. And during his free time, he coaches school children on personality improvement, career counseling, and interpersonal skills. As a free thing, he does that. And today, Ganesh is here to speak on his, actually this is part of his research work which he did at NTU Singapore, and where, you know, he's taken a different approach for measuring knowledge disparities among nations in societies. And he's going to share a part of his research with us today. Welcome, Ganesh. Thank you for accepting for the speech. Thank you. Over to Ganesh.
Thanks, Gopal, and all in the audience. Thanks for giving me an opportunity to present one of my research topics that I have did some 3 years back and some updations I have done continuously over the past three and a half years. So this is, I would take from the bottom up, the Gini coefficient, what is knowledge, and how, I think probably something I would like to open up is, what's a knowledge society and how we can appreciate knowledge at a society level. That thing I would like to take through in the first few slides. So the agenda would be this. First, we will be setting the context of what is knowledge-based development at a society level. And we take at the organization level, similarly we can see what's a knowledge society. Do you call Korea knowledge society? Do you call India an evolving knowledge society? And second and third are two frameworks we have tried to evolve. One is the knowledge spectrum, the second is the K-Gini coefficient, and finally I plan to open up a discussion based on these two models. Yeah, thank you. So first, let us go back some 10 years. I believe 10 years back, what would have been the cost of a motorbike you would have bought? We can make a wild guess. Normal motorbike we are buying. 30,000, 40,000. So today, let's take a 30,000, 35,000. So today, what is the value of the mobile phone we carry? 40. Yeah. The cost of a motorbike we take some 10 years back. And what is the cost of a mobile phone? And secondly, 10 years back, if you are going for a birthday party or a wedding, what is the gift you are most likely to buy? Bouquet, yeah. Clock, yeah. Cooker, yeah. So generally something very hard, we can say. But today, if you go for a wedding or marriage, what we are going to buy?
Gift card,
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. We can say, that time, gift was equivalent to gold or silver. You can call a vessel, metal, anything. It can be brass, it can be a gold lamp, or that thing. But today, gift is a gadget. Most probably, even a 10-year-old for his birthday expects something like an iPad today. So today, we have evolved like this. From two-wheeler to a mobile phone, and from gold and silver to iPad and iPhone. So what we are trying to appreciate over here is, this is a quote from Michael Spence in the Growth Report, which we have tried to illustrate over here. It is, we are increasingly not land, not minerals, not oil is a resource. It is the knowledge you could put to it, the value you add to it, that is appreciated. That is why earlier gold, you give to your most loved one, now you are giving an iPad or iPhone. Because everybody appreciates knowledge, application of knowledge on those tools. Similarly, a corporate example over here. Probably for people not familiar with the book value is, what is the value of the share at the time of issue? For example, Google, when it went public, the share for its price is $85, that is fixed. And now, as yesterday, the Google share price is $810, which is 10 times. If we take for TCS, it is about 150 times. So that is the difference we say. The book value and the market value difference, that is the definition we call as intellectual capital. an organization, a brick and mortar organization, would have more of capital and less of intellectual. But whereas when you go for electronic and evolving organizations, the black pillar over here, the intangible, the human part, the structural part, the customer relation, these things are interesting actually, the skills and knowledge. There is a very common saying, the best knowledge of your organization walks out at 6 o'clock in the evening. You have the best technology, you have the best machines, everything. But people, that is the most important. And secondly, how much you have structured your people process. So through patents, through processes, database, networks, so how much that has helped. And thirdly, customer capital. There is one common saying in consumer market, for every new, to getting a new customer, you spend 8 times the effort to as much as retaining a customer. So that's again the importance of customer capital over here, which forms the intangible component. This is something I did out of my interest. I took 3 Indian software companies, TCS, HCL and Infosys. They had a balance sheet. In that they show what is a tangible and intangible asset. If you look at this part, this black part, that was over 95%. They took a 3 years for all these 3 companies. It was very much at the 95% limit. So given this, the importance of knowledge is nobody can, there's a common saying, we can't do this now. Companies often say, we cannot do knowledge management now. But now the saying is, we cannot afford to do, not to do this now. So that's the way you start looking at it. Next is, let's take 2 companies, sorry, 2 countries, Ghana. Ghana, what comes to your mind probably? Ghana is a country in the coastal belt of Africa. It's near equator. Oil, yeah, very much. Oil. Yeah, definitely. So first thing that came to my mind is football. Both South Korea, when I mean Korea, it's South Korea. Both Korea and Ghana, they have very high passion for football. Like Korea have been in the semi-finals of World Cup some 10 years back, and Ghana regularly in the round of 16. So football is something they are together, but the other things which they are not together. One is Ghana has, Kumar told, they have evergreen forests, thick vegetation, excellent equatorial, it rains every day. But Korea, it's known for dry winters. They have a patchy summer and a very dry winter. So the temperature varies like that. And thirdly, as we know, Ghana means gold, oil, cocoa, timber, what all the raw materials you get out of it. But Korea, the moment we think of Korea, Samsung comes to our mind, Hyundai comes to our mind. So that's the way both the countries have been positioned themselves. When we say, when this comes to my mind for Ghana or Korea, it doesn't happen on its own. It's a focused national policy which they have been evolved. So that way, World Bank did a similar thing and said, around we take 1958, at least Ghana is actually an inch higher or equal, we can say, in terms of per capita GDP. And now after Korea roared really in the 70s and 80s, Korea is way, way ahead of it. That's history. But the interesting thing is, what's the differentiator? How much has physical and human capital differentiated, and how much has knowledge differentiated? That is almost 2 times. The knowledge has been twice as much differentiator as any other factor. So in the macroeconomic level also, knowledge is of course power and it has its own lead. Now I would like to present the research work we have done and how we have evolved the model over the next 5 to 10 minutes. So our research problem is, can we study the relationship between income generation and knowledge at a society level? For this study, we have taken society to be a country because of data availability issues. So how to measure the knowledge of a country? For that, we took this World Bank AIM scores. That is a very reputed data released by World Bank. They did latest in 2008. So we took that as an indicator for knowledge score of a country. They give numbers as well as a scale rating between 0 to 10. And per capita income in terms of PPP, that is taken as an indicator of economic activity of that country. So that's the basis. And here again, we didn't want to compare apples with grapes. So what we did is we tried to group similar countries. For that, we took the UN HDI ratings, United Nations Human Development Index, and grouped the first. We took randomly took 20 countries out of the first 35. Then another 20 from the 36 to 115 bucket, and another 20 from 115 to it goes till 193. So we took 20 samples each from these three buckets. This is to avoid comparing any inequals. So based on this, for a representation analysis, we have normalized this and then analysis. We have broadly constructed two models, as we have told. One is the knowledge spectrum and another is the K-Gini coefficient, which we'll take through. So knowledge spectrum is based on this. As we see, one is a normalized knowledge score on a scale of 0 to 1. So we put all these, how much has this country scored, how much has this country, I'll show a representation how it comes like. So knowledge score in increasing order is taken on the Y, and what is the per capita GDP normalized one, that is taken on the X. So probably how we can infer, I'm giving a representative numbers here, representative countries for example, but in later results we can verify these also. So first is take something over here, Saudi Arabia, Iran. They have very good natural resources, oil, gold. Oil is gold, so they have oil. But overall, their knowledge coefficient score may not be very high. But still, they have very high income, but their knowledge score is less. So for these, we call as other resource-driven society. Next are a set of countries which have deficiency in knowledge score as well as normal income. So for these, we call knowledge-deficient societies, probably Bangladesh, Somalia, they come under this. They don't have resource, they don't have talent also. They have not evolved with talent, that way I could put it. Third is, there are countries which have actually risen up very well in the knowledge sphere, but they are yet to commercialize it into per capita GDP. So that way, their knowledge intensive, probably India, the last 15 years, we can say has evolved into a knowledge intensive society. And of course, there are societies which are reflective. They have knowledge, they have put it into production, they have put into products, they have put into financial value, they are able to sell it. Japan and US, they are called knowledge reflective societies. So this is a sample countries we have given. So we will go to the exact comparison of how we update later. So this framework, is it fine? Or anybody has something to? So in this, as I told you earlier, we wanted to compare likes and likes. So based on the Human Development Index, we developed the high human development and compared with them. For example, Finland, UK, Germany, US, Canada, they would be in the high HDI bucket. And the second set of countries is Jordan, Croatia, Bulgaria, Malaysia, Iran, Mongolia, they would be in the medium HDI group. And in the low HDI group, it's Kenya, Madagascar, Yemen, Nepal, Bangladesh, India, Laos, Cameroon. This is based on the HDI rank that has been given by UN. So the thing is, we are taking mainly the medium and low HDI for presentation here. For example, here you see Jordan, Iran. Geographically, they are in very similar areas. But, and also the, as you see, the environmental issues, challenges they face are same. But how come Jordan is in a knowledge intensive quadrant and our Iran is in another resource driven? Probable reason we thought is Iran over the 15-20 years have been evolving policies that have been inward policies. So they have been going in, so the knowledge flow has been highly disrupted. So that way they are in this quadrant. Whereas Jordan, although in that area, is said to be very open society. So that way the knowledge flow would have helped them to move over to this quarter. Similarly, among this block, these countries that we can say these are better off in all aspects, like Bulgaria, Malaysia. Malaysia has evolved over the 70s and 80s, Mahathir's period, into both a resource-rich as well as a knowledge-rich society. Similarly, Brazil, Russia have moved up. So that sums up this medium HDI. how countries have been differentiated. Next we come to this group of low HDI group, where we have this matrix. So here India we find as knowledge reflective. We probably, you can ask, why I put India in the knowledge intensive block over there and now here. There I put for demo representation purpose. Here this is based on the study we have done. We from the normalized knowledge score, which is normalized income, India here comes in this knowledge reflective block. Along with India, there are of course something, as any research turns up, there are something shocking, like for example Namibia was very high. This entire group, if you took, Namibia was in the very high knowledge reflective society, which made us to think we have to probe into internal factors. Probably have they used their, one thing Namibia is very successful, World Bank itself has acknowledged this, example I would like to pull out, whereas rest of Africa is very problem, not very good in AIDS management. Namibia has done it very well. When asked how, the president of Namibia said, when in 1990 World Bank said we'll offer this, we'll offer you this for AIDS, for managing this epidemic, the president clearly said, you give us money, we know how to manage. And Namibia, how they manage this epidemic was, they never did for propaganda or poster or TV campaign as many others do. They focused on the religious institutions, cultural institutions, and through them they targeted this epidemic, and they were quite successful. Probably that is one thing that made us place them. That may be many things, but what we thought is, for taking each one, it's a, that itself is a thesis sort of thing. Why this country is there, why this country is there. So on a broad scale, what we infer from here is, this knowledge intensive block, sorry, the knowledge intensive block over here have high knowledge scores, but they are yet to commercialize their knowledge into product, services and monetary gain. This knowledge reflective block, they are good in knowledge, they are also good in money. We are not doing a causal analysis. Are they good in knowledge and then they became good in money, or they became good in money then they became good in knowledge? That causal analysis right now is, we did not do. And there is of course this other resource driven, of course this is Cameroon and Laos also, they are rich in oil. So probably we thought of naming this oil and gold block, the other resource driven, because they are valued hot resources. So this is one framework we try to put in to stratify companies based on, sorry, stratify nations based on their thing. Since in the interest of time, I'm going to the next model. After that, we'll take the questions together. So next is, I'm coming to this Gini coefficient, which was invented by an Italian mathematician, and hence called, his name is Gini, and so we have started using the same name over here. So take an example. If we are some 20 people over here, and the overall income of this room say is 20,000 rupees, and each one of us earn 1,000 rupees, then if we map the share of people and the share of income, it would be a straight line. First one person at 1,000 rupees, 2 person at 2,000 rupees, 3 person at 3,000, so it would be a line of equality, right? But that doesn't happen. The law of equality are only in theory. In practice and implementation, we don't go for it. So that's why the Gini coefficient has become increasingly popular nowadays. How it happens? The top bottom 10% have 1% of income. Top 10% have 20%. The rich are getting richer and the poor are getting poorer. The famous dialogue that holds good here. So basically the Gini coefficient, it's a coefficient given. It varies between 0 and 1. Higher the Gini, higher the dispersion of income. For example, in some African countries, it is as high as 0.8. So the higher segment of population have so much wealth and the lower segment are so poor. But we are not going into the qualitative, what Gini is good, that is beyond the scope of this. But thing is, Gini measures the intra-societal dispersion of income, I would like to put it. So that is the economic definition of Gini. And we have adopted the same to a knowledge society. That's what we put as K-Gini. In this, what we are trying to put is similar to that graph. That graph, similarly we put the cumulative knowledge and cumulative per capita income. And there we have put the individual score. Here we have put the per capita. So probably analogous to here, if let us say we compute a knowledge score for this team of 20 people, and the everybody has a knowledge score of 10 and everybody gets an income of 10,000 rupees, then this would be an ideal distribution. Everybody leverages knowledge to the same extent for income generation, that I would like to state. The ideal case, everybody reflects the knowledge in the same degree. But in the real case, as we know, there are people who are very good in speaking, people who are very good in presenting, people who are very good in thinking. So they are in the top block and they make more use of the knowledge, they make more commercialized the knowledge. So that way, we also want to give a Gini score for various groups based on this similar cumulative graph theory. So is this formulation fine? Because before I go to the next slide, understanding on this is very important. So is this understandable? So for these three blocks, similarly high HDI, the top 1 to 120 among the top 35 countries and the 20 among 35 to 115 countries and 20 from the 115 plus group, we did this income generation versus knowledge score graph. As we see here, for the high HDI countries, it is almost near the ideal case. For the medium, it's a slight dispersion. For the low HDI, it's a very high dispersion. Probably, as we all know, knowledge is a commodity. It has to have a market. And every market has enabling conditions. It can be political, it can be economical, it can be technological. Probably from this, what we can infer is, in the high HDI countries, the platform, the ability, there is a very common platform where you can commercialize your knowledge. So there is no major dispersion between knowledge and income creation in this block. And here slightly it becomes over, and here it is very high. So that's an inference we can make. Here they are providing a much level field for transforming your knowledge into economic value. Whereas here there will be many factors, instability of government, military rule, come what may, cultural practices, people tend to save, many factors. But trend we have seen is this. So this is the basis of our study, and we did this some 3 years back, and I thought of presenting a new paradigm to it in the next two slides. So the knowledge spectrum and the Gini analysis, these were the crux of our research we did 3 years back. So how we can use it, how we can discuss it today over the next 10 minutes probably. Is it possible? We have a lot of business units in a big organization. Let us do some internal study of the knowledge score. It can be a survey, it can be some measure of a knowledge score for each business unit. And we have the commercial data, how much income generation, or rather we can take profit generation, whichever we want. I have put income generation because that is easily available. There is a direct thing we can take. So on this x-axis we can take this income generation, and on y-axis we take the knowledge score, and we put a k Gini. If the k Gini is good, Gini coefficient is 0.001, then it's excellent. Across your organization, everybody is leveraging on knowledge to income generation the same way. May not be in the best way, I say. If all the people are normal, then it doesn't mean we are doing great. So the dispersion is not very high. In fact, dispersion is good. That is what people say, dispersion, the dispersion is good. So probably if you do a Gini analysis and you find, wow, my Gini is greater than 0.5, there is something alarming. So can we do a knowledge spectrum analysis? So to identify where my business stand. So knowledge spectrum, probably I hypothesize this thing. A company with some business units, they have a very high Gini coefficient. So they run for this knowledge spectrum. So they make this. Again, like this is the income part of it, and this is the knowledge score part of it. As we see, this block, there is probably some practice that gets me good money, but I know the knowledge score is not good. Let us take something like an oil exploration. I'm getting good money, but I know my knowledge source, like my ability to find a new rig, is not good. That means, although you are making good money, you have high risk of competition. Anybody can come in and grab your place. They need some political support, some economical baggage. So that way, however much money you make, but if you are in this quadrant, then it means you have to heavily invest in technology, in knowledge, so that you get some differentiators from rest of the organization. Next, there are few business units of my knowledge score, I don't know how it goes, and how about revenue, we pay the salary through that. So there are some units like that. There is no market value and there is no USP. What do you have in those business units? We don't know such units. So probably those units you can sell or move out. That may be a better practice. I suggest all suggestions. Definitely I'll open this for discussion. Suggestions. Next is, we have this knowledge intensive. I have did some excellent research in these BUs over the past 5-7 years. I know these have got a capacity to scale up and reach the horizon. So what to do with this? Man, come on, productize. The knowledge has to be sold. Unless it is sold, you will remain knowledge intensive, you can't commercialize. So productize the knowledge in whatever way you can. It can be a product, it can be a service, whatever way you can. Make them possible, you may hit the market. Make them as USPs. And finally, we come over here. Yeah, it's great. My knowledge score is good. I am very good in handling these types of client, this type of business unit. And my income is also good. It doesn't mean I can rest, because there are already people coming up. Since you have the income and knowledge, they are comprising. Probably many people are in this area. And unless you innovate continuously, innovating continuously here is a prerequisite, so that you contain to maintain lead. Otherwise, there is very high possibility in the short term you will be pushed over here, and in the long term over here. So that is something at business unit level. I thought we can open up for a discussion on this. So I'd like to hear the views of people. How is it? How reflective this is of a knowledge and income generation pattern?
So for this, when you apply this to a BU, on the y-axis obviously it's going to be the knowledge score of those BUs.
Yeah.
X-axis is the income generated by the BU. Now, are there any approaches for knowledge score calculation for BUs? Have you thought about any?
Yes, we generally have a knowledge audit for various organizations. It has to vary case by case. Either you can have some measures, number of patents, number of white papers, number of best practices. Those, it's an organization-centric thing we should do. Probably number of PhDs. That's why we can use the Scandia Navigator model, where you classify your thing into this process-centric ones, human-centric one, and the structural ones. These patents, white papers come into structural. Probably number of PhDs, years of experience in a domain, that comes into this human factor. And this process thing is how much of best practices, how much of good process-centric things you have, that comes into this process. So that's a different model we have to build in. But that we are not going in, that maybe we have to explore definitely.
So whether you have done a research where the country is having the knowledge, but in the production wise they have not done so far. Something like Japan, they say they don't have the resources, but they imported the resources and they're making use of the knowledge. But is there any countries where they have the knowledge but they don't have the resources? Whether you have found anything like that?
Exactly, resource we have not did. We have did for this income generation. The country has a very good reserve of gold. Here we have not taken it into, because we are taking the GDP. So what is their production they are taking? That is what we are taking as a measure. So in terms of production, as we saw, among the low HDI countries, India felt in that block. India has got a good GDP, but if we take it per capita, it is less. But a knowledge score of India, of Indians in India, is very high, because knowledge has a synergy effect. One knowledge plus one knowledge is not equal to two. It is something greater than that. So because of that, generally we see countries with high population, they end up with a higher knowledge reserve, provided they give good education facilities and good social climate. They have a multiplicative knowledge effect, because that knowledge grows exponentially. So probably India comes here in that study. But as we take a larger sample, it can vary. As of now, we have found this India and Bulgaria, Croatia, those set of countries come over here.
Israel also fall in this. Very high knowledge.
Exactly, yeah.
Less resources.
Yeah, this is actually Singapore. Yeah, here what the is very important, you take the scrite specimens, because we are doing a relative rating over here. We are using a normalized scale. So if you want to compare some 10 countries, those 10 countries, that 10 countries will get a good score. But for example, a country over here, Singapore may be here, here. But if you take some 10 more examples, probably the income of Singapore is higher in that group. So it might move over here. So the samples we take is a cardinal for the output, whatever we get over here.
Scientist, you know, in terms of the degrees in India, it's a lot more than any other country in the world.
Yeah.
Okay, but if you look at the output of this, it's pretty small, right?
Yeah.
So in that case, you know, having a degree can be considered construed as a knowledge portion, or having the output from that is considered as a.
Yeah, exactly. Portion. Having a degree would come over here, like here. Knowledge score, if I have very high number of engineers in my country, my knowledge score is high. Actually, the World Bank KM scores, it is computed by some close to 74 parameters. They have grouped it among them, number of researchers, number of engineers, and number of PhDs. They have took all these factors, and that is what we have used for this knowledge indication. And next is, how much of my PhDs have productized, how much of them have did some thing like commercialized. If they would do a patent, how much of this patent is commercialized, how much of this is made into money, that would be reflected in this axis. I agree, we have taken a representative measures. This KM index we have taken is a composite score of 74 different inputs. And this GDP per capita in PPP terms is something people can question. But this is a framework we have tried to put up, and we can contextualize it accordingly. Yeah, that is what we have tried to propose, like in our organization, if we can, instead of countries, if we can take different business units as societies or countries, and we plot their knowledge score over this y-axis, and their income generation capacities over this x-axis.
Income generation of the organization or the individual?
Business units.
Of the
business. Yeah.
So when you take the business
units income, how do you say that is related only to the knowledge and not to the outcome of the services as perceived by the client? Because the knowledge, per se, the individual. The individuals may have knowledge, but if that knowledge is not perceived by the client, then that knowledge cannot be monetized.
Exactly.
So if it is not monetized, then the x-axis won't grow.
Yeah.
So how do you actually classify, what sort of a criteria you try to give it to make sure that that has the right knowledge, the particular organization?
Okay. As I told you, the most common model for measuring knowledge is Scandia Navigator, where we define knowledge in three spheres. One is the structural one, and second is the people, and third is the process. In people, probably the qualified people, years of experience, those things come in, then the human process. And second, we have the structural, how many patents you have did, how many publications you have did, those things come under the structural. And in process, how fast your approval regime is in this business unit, how good is the closure between a business offer starting and an ending. Those things we have to incorporate and bring about a composite score. That's what we are trying to propose over here. So when I say knowledge score, it involves the customer focus, it involves the human focus, it involves the process, it involves the structural, all those elements we need to evolve into a composite score. So that's a cumulative thing we are proposing as a knowledge score. Yes, of course, customer, those things are pretty important. Not only the how good the people you are, how good they are generating, those things are very much important, yeah.
One was wondering about the relevant knowledge.
Okay.
Second is, in case of an organization, or even in case of individual, what about market knowledge? you know, the wisdom part I'm talking about, you know, or the application. Like for example, again, even to take an Indian situation, we all know throwing things outside is bad. But you know, the application, we don't do it.
Yeah.
Awareness is there, but we don't do it. No, there's somehow you'll have to bring that also here, because otherwise I think the knowledge, intensive and knowledge reflective, make it slightly confused.
Yeah, exactly. That's it. That's based on a working definition. If you make a wrong definition, then you end up in a wrong prism, and that would be a lesson. Probably, I know it is bad to throw a garbage outside, but I still throw. So I am good in the knowledge, but I am poor in the application. So I'll be here, knowledge intensive, which means I know I'm, but I'm not doing. But actually, if I have did it, I should have been here. So, like any model, if you construct it with the right inputs, you get the right output. Otherwise, the possible input would be one of the findings of our model. So that's exactly the multiple factors we have to factor in to develop a composite scale.
What do you think would be the reason for human development index being low, while knowledge intensive or knowledge reflective?
Like probably we can take the case of China. China's income has been roaring over the years, but probably the social factors, how much the people are free, how much the society is open. So open society and people freedom, those are all factors. The HDP again is a score that is derived by the human, by UN, based on many inputs. So those factors include the social, how stable is your economy. Your nation. Economically, you can be very good, but unless you have a stability in terms of governance, it's of course a problem. So that way, yes, there are cases where they have the political and social issues can affect your HDP scores, whereas where your economic score can still be high. Okay. So thanks for giving opportunity. Thanks.